$50,000 down payment, buy this instead. If you had roughly, let's say, $55,000 to invest in anything, I would not purchase a house right now. I would purchase Bitcoin. That's it. That's the video. Oh, you're probably wondering why. Isn't purchasing a house, quote unquote, a great investment? Well, the Bitcoin bubble burst at some point. I mean, just look at the volatility over the last couple of weeks, right? Right? Well, if you stick around till the end, I'll tell you why owning Bitcoin will be a much better and cheaper investment than any real estate deal you'll likely come across. So, lovingly, gently, tenderly, caress that like button for the YouTube algorithm, and let's get started. You're watching Finance Squared, and I'm your host, Derek West. You know, the one thing that has been a staple of financial advice my whole life, and probably the life of everyone in the U.S., probably the world, low these last few centuries, is that buying a home is the best investment of your life. I understand why people feel that way, and why they would say that. A home provides a place for you to lay your hat down, so to speak. It represents your piece of this world, a place where you can establish your family's wealth. And if you play your cards right, that property that you purchase will provide you with a nice large chunk of appreciation once you've paid it all off. That's mostly right, but in a lot of respects, I disagree. I'm not a fan of purchasing real estate merely to live in if I can't pay in cash. There are caveats, which I'll get into, but in general, buying a house, to me, to live in, is fine. But I consider it to not be a great investment, and I consider it to be bad debt. When one thinks of bad debt, they typically think of expensive dinners and fancy restaurants on a credit card, or extravagant automobile purchases like Lamborghinis, using bank loans, or even endless online spending, again, using credit cards. If that's what you think when you think of bad debt, then you're right. I would consider that purchasing a house to live in should be in that category as well. Why do I say that? Here's my reasoning. Most people will counter what I say in that house buying a house is bad debt by saying that if you buy a house, you can count on it appreciating over time. Therefore, a down payment that you make will be a good investment. Now, it is true that most, not all, but most real estate appreciates over time. It's not as much as people think, by the way. You know, the average U.S. real estate value has gained less than 1% when adjusted for inflation. If you purchased a house in 1970 for $100,000, that same house will be worth $625,873 today, which represents about a 6x increase in value. But that's mostly because of inflation. Salaries and the cost of bread have increased at about the same amount, making a $629,000 house upper middle class today, just like a $100,000 house was upper middle class in 1970. When you see the value of certain real estate increase by 10, 20, sometimes 30 times their value in just a couple of years, you're probably looking at real estate in neighborhoods that are highly desirable, in places or locations that people are moving to. Think swank neighborhoods in LA or San Francisco. Well, maybe not LA and San Francisco, Dallas or Houston. Those places are in high demand to live, and therefore their prices appreciate much faster than average. Even so, that doesn't make purchasing a house a good investment. You see, a house, unlike a lot of other investments that simply appreciate over time, require you to make monthly mortgage payments and real estate taxes, homeowners insurance. If you purchase a house with a low down payment, you have to pay mortgage insurance, and let's not forget utilities. Not to mention maintaining the property, making sure all repairs happen, the lawn is manicured, etc. All these are ongoing required payments that must be met. If you fail to make one or many of them, you're putting yourself at risk and in danger of not having your investment at all. These are all carrying costs, and they can be quite substantial. All of these expenses mount on each other. Combined with the interest you will be paying on the home, the amount of money you spent on it may actually be greater than the return you can expect on any appreciation. For example, if you purchase a house for $200,000 and sell it for $300,000 10 years later, that sounds like a $100,000 profit, right? Well, let's examine the numbers more closely. If you pay $1,000 per month for principal and interest and insurance, plus $300 per month for utilities, you will have paid $156,000 for that entire decade, meaning you will have paid $56,000 more than the gain from the appreciation that you supposedly received. That's assuming no repairs or upgrades were needed. And if you spent $3,000 per year on routine maintenance, that'll be an additional $30,000 over the decade. Now imagine a major kitchen upgrade, you know, for flooring, whatever, spending anywhere from $20,000 to $50,000. Adding that to the cost of the other things you paid for the entire decade, now you're close to paying $236,000 to get $100,000 gain, meaning you've lost over $130,000, and that's not including capital gains taxes. Let's not even get into the transaction costs associated, inflation driving down the value of your dollar, or the fact that your house may not rise in value that dramatically over 10 years. In some places, prices might actually fall. For example, New York. And then there's the cash flow problem. For an investment that will likely not do anything but burn a hole in your pocket, it doesn't really get much worse than a house. The thing that really gets me the most is that most real estate purchases by consumers using consumer-grade mortgages don't cash flow at all. You can expect cash flows when you invest in anything from dividend-yielding stocks, bonds, mutual funds, ETFs, and even REITs, you know, real estate investment trusts. But real estate that you live in will not give you such a luxury. With one exception, a house that is part of a 2-4 unit complex that you rent out to others. Now that could actually provide you with cash flow as you live in it. That said though, in a lot of instances, those don't cash flow either. And quite frankly, you'll be lucky to break even in a situation like that. Not to be negative on the whole topic, But you got to be pretty, astute and savvy to find a fourplex, duplex, triplex that you can get into that will cash flow positively. But I'm not saying that you shouldn't buy a house to live in. You have to live somewhere. And if you're sick and tired of renting and having those prices go up as well, but then by all means, own and have the cost of living be fixed for a number of years. Just be very aware that what you're purchasing is not an investment, but is in fact debt. And it's not even good debt. Good debt to me is anything that you use, is anything that when you borrow money, you can expect to get some money back in return and cash flow. Well, what should you purchase instead if you had $50,000 just lying around? Bitcoin. Why do I say that? Let's be real with ourselves. Bitcoin is going to the moon. Many economists and finance guys in the know are predicting that Bitcoin will hit at least $100,000. With one analyst, Charlie Morris, the chief investment officer of ByteTree Asset Management, thinking that Bitcoin could hit $1 million by 2044. He argues that gold exchange-traded funds attracted $41 billion last year, and that gold investors will be switching to Bitcoin as the price of it just continues to go through the roof. If those same investors of gold put that same amount of money into Bitcoin, Charlie reasons that the price could approach $100,000. If that rate of inflow continues every year until 2044, that could justify a price point of $1 million Bitcoin by 2036, if consumer price inflation averages 2.5% per year. Or by 2032, if inflation averages 5% per year, or about a 20-fold gain from current price levels. Now, that is a tad bit bullish, even for a crypto geek like me. But even if you don't buy that particular price point, the mainstream acceptance by much of the financial industry has been, it's quite clear that the mainstream acceptance of Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies by much of the financial industry has been responsible for driving the price of Bitcoin and other altcoins up through the roof. According to CoinMetric, the number of Bitcoins locked in addresses holding between 1,000 to 10,000 Bitcoin has increased significantly since late 2020. This is a sign of increased participation by high net worth individuals, you know, the swanky, rich, and famous, folks like Elon Musk, and institutions like Bank of New York Mellon, Tesla, etc. We've not even discussed the dangers of hyperinflation that Bitcoin and other altcoins were invented to help sidestep. You see, many fear that stimulus packages, like the ones being considered by Congress and other places around the globe, will be more of a norm and less of an aberration in the coming years, thanks to the pandemic lockdowns and other economic headwinds, signaling a coming hyperinflation wave. People and institutions looking to protect themselves are looking to buy early. So how can you get in the game? Perhaps buy fractionally. Well, fractional purchasing of investments, not a terrible idea. If you don't have $50,000 lying around, then that might be your only way to go if you decide to invest at all. After all, as Bitcoin rises, any fraction that you own will rise with it. I may have mentioned this before, but I'm not a fan of dollar cost averaging, particularly when it comes to trying to avoid downside risks to investing. I'd rather myself and other people study the investments that they want to purchase, come away with confidence that they are the right moves to make, and go all in, ready to write it down till the bottom with no fear, because they A, have an emergency fund stowed away, B, are invested in other solid growing instruments like index funds or ETFs, C, they have adjusted their psychologies to market realities and not the other way around. But if you don't have the money, then you don't have the money. And at that point, you have no other choice except Ethereum and other altcoins. See, Ethereum is the other cryptocurrency that will look to rise in the wake of Bitcoin. Others like Chainlink, Monero, Dogecoin will rise as folks look for alternatives to the king of crypto. Other alternatives that you probably should consider would be subscribing to this channel and turning on post notifications. We may not have our own alt currency in circulation yet, but we do provide some of the best coverage on the topic in an easy to understand and entertaining format, and we're just getting started. So remember, a goal without a plan is a wish. A goal with a plan and no action is a wish list. Take action on your investment life. If you have $50,000 lying around, drop it on Bitcoin and not a house if you have confidence that this is an investment for you. Also, keeping in mind, I'm not an investment advisor, and that you should always consult a certified investment advisor and not listen to people on YouTube for any of your investment advice. Keep in mind, this channel and others like it is for entertainment purposes only. And now that we're clear on that topic, I'm going to get out of here, guys. Talk to you later. Peace.